Right now, we're very privileged to have the greatest battlefield guide of the Civil War, Ed Bars. And we've talked about some of the major battles of the war, but now we're going to be talking about a raid, Grierson's raid. And how are you doing today, Mr. Bars?
Very well. I've just got back and spent the weekend in I spent most of last week out in Colorado looking at Indian War battlefields.
What battlefield were you talking about?
Indian War battlefields in the 1870s.
Well, today our topic is Grierson's raid. And our first question is, who was Colonel Grierson?
Colonel Grierson was a person you would not visualize to be an important player or one of the heroes of the Civil War. He was born in the Pittsburgh area, and as a young man in his mid-teens, he was kicked in the face by a horse, and he hated horses. By the time of the Civil War, he's living in the area of, he moved earlier in his life after he became an adult, in which he taught music. He moved to Jacksonville, Illinois, which is probably about 50 miles south and west of Springfield. Was teaching, was a music teacher, being a patriotic fellow. He married and he had children at this time. He volunteered for service. And was, as luck would have it, assigned to the cavalry, and this is what he will lead during the raid. And from his youth, he had not been a particular admirer of horses.
So, what was the point of Grierson's raid?
All right, Grierson is a commander of the Illinois Cavalry Regiment and a brigade of Illinois cavalrymen. This is in the late autumn of 1862 and the winter of 62 and 63. They're based in North Mississippi. At this time, Grant is in the process of carrying out his Vicksburg campaign. But this time, he's tried an overland advance on Vicksburg, which we talked before, and ended up with Sherman being defeated at the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou. He has passed through a number of expeditions in which he tried to bypass Vicksburg using Porter's fleet in cooperation. But now time is running out for him. He has started his troops under General McClernand, moving southward from the area of Milliken's Bend, which is about 20 miles upstream from Vicksburg on the Louisiana side. And they're moving southward to bypass Vicksburg to the west and hopefully be able to cross the Mississippi River, which they will do during the closing phase of the Grierson raid. That's when Grant will have tried to cross the Mississippi at Grand Gulf on the 29th day of April, but the Confederate river batteries are too strong. So he has Porter run his gunboats past Grand Gulf. They march the army down the west side of the river out of range of the Confederate batteries. And, of course, as we discussed before, they cross the Mississippi River and land at Bruinsburg on the last day of April and will fight the Battle of Port Gibson on the first day of May. Now, Grant will work with General Hurlbut, his subordinate up at Memphis, to launch a cavalry raid that will be led by Colonel Grierson, that will begin in North Mississippi, just on the north side of the Tennessee line, and proceed southward into Mississippi, traveling along what a watershed known as the Tom Bigby Ridge, as Grierson starts southward following the Pontotoc Ridge, passing through towns along it, such as New Ripley, New Albany, and Pontotoc. When he gets in the Pontotoc area, the Confederate cavalry operating in northeast Mississippi to draw them, to keep them from following Grierson as he heads further southward, Grierson will detach one of his regiments, the 2nd Iowa Cavalry under Colonel Hatch. Incidentally, Grierson almost missed starting on the raid. He was on a leave back in Jacksonville, Illinois, and the raid starts on the 17th, at daybreak on the 17th day of April. He gets back just hours before the raid started, and if he had not arrived when he did, it would have been known as Colonel Hatch's raid, and I doubt if Hatch would have been able to carry out successfully. So, when he gets in the Pontotoc area, he detaches Colonel Hatch's regiment, and they'll demonstrate eastward toward the Mobile and Ohio Railroad. This is this north-south railroad running about on an average of about 20 miles east of the Alabama-Mississippi border. And the Confederates fall for this feint, and the cavalry in that part of Mississippi will follow, northeast Mississippi, will follow Hatch back to their starting point. So he's eliminated that threat. Then he heads on southward. He detached Hatch on the 21st. He passes through Starkville, the present location of the Mississippi State, passes through Decatur, Mississippi, about 20 miles north of the Mississippi, Southern Railroad of Mississippi, and on the morning of the 25th, he gallops in to Newton Station. That's the station. Newton is halfway between Jackson and Meridian. So they've reached Newton Station, and they rip up the railroad, the Southern Railroad, for a short distance both east and west of Newton Station, thus cutting the Southern Railroad of Mississippi and drawing Pemberton's attention to looking east, not toward Grant moving down the other side of the river on the Louisiana side. And Grierson will then take his force and make a demonstration toward Garlandville. Garlandville would be a small town south of the main line of the Southern Railroad of Mississippi. And if he continued doing that, he would strike the Mobile and Ohio Railroad at Enterprise. That's to draw the Confederate attention toward Meridian, an important rail junction, as you can gather, because that's where the Southern Railroad is crossed by the Mobile and Ohio. Pemberton will order General Loring's men, who are up in North Mississippi, a division of about 5,000 men. His mission will be to try and catch General Grierson. Now, maybe if he caught up with him or outmaneuvered him, he could destroy him, but he can't keep up with him. So Grierson, after demonstrating toward Enterprise, then changes direction and travels a route about 25 miles south of and parallel to the Southern Railroad, going west. And on the 27th day of April, he crosses the Pearl River, a very formidable water barrier, flowing north and south, or heads west, and strikes and cuts the north-south railroad, the Mississippi Central Railroad, about 20 miles south of Jackson, drawing Pemberton's attention that way. Now, since he knows on the 27th, it's a very important day on the 27th when Grierson, with his 900 men and battle artillery, crosses the Mississippi River at Georgetown. He's going to strike the North-South Railroad at Hazelhurst, Mississippi. That's 20 miles south of Pemberton's headquarters at Jackson. At this time, Grant is moving into position to try to cross the Mississippi River at Grand Gulf. Colonel Grierson now heads south and west toward toward Natchez to draw the Confederate attention toward Natchez and draw the Confederate cavalry that is supposed to be screening, watching for Grant's crossing of the river at Grand Gulf, and when he finally crosses at Bruinsburg, Colonel Wirt Adams, who is supposed to be waiting for him, heads south and east to Union Church, where he meets Grierson. Now, Grierson now fools Adams. He now turns south, heads almost due east, reaches the North-South Railroad, the Mississippi Central, or at Brookhaven, where the Union Confederates have a base. That's about 30 miles north of the Louisiana line on the railroad. He then tears up the railroad, running south from Brookhaven, and then moves westward again, traveling along a route about 20 miles west of and parallel to the North-South Railroad, and about 40 to 50 miles east of Natchez. He now has the Confederates who are in Port Hudson, which is 20 miles north of Baton Rouge. Baton Rouge is held by the Union. In fact, the Union at this time controlled the Mississippi River from Port Hudson, 20 miles north of Baton Rouge, to above Vicksburg. So what does Grierson do then? He moves back to the North-South Railroad, tears up some track, and then heads for Baton Rouge, heading southeast. He's now west. He's now back. He's in Louisiana for the first time. And who's following behind him? Wirt Adams with his cavalry, who had been, as you would say, he's maneuvered him out, as you would use if you're using in basketball. He's maneuvered Wirt Adams out of his jock strap. Instead of covering and watching for Grant as he comes ashore at Bruinsburg on the 20th day, on the last day of April, Adams is chasing Grierson's men southward down the Mississippi, the North-South Railroad. When he gets beyond the area of Osaka, he leaves the railroad and heads for Baton Rouge, the Union base.
Ed, we need to take a short break. You're listening to Ask the Lawyer with me, Mike Connors. Our guest is Ed Bars, talking about Grierson's raid. Welcome back. You're listening to Ask the Lawyer with me, Mike Connors. Our guest is Ed Bars, who's going to continue about Grierson's raid.
The Confederates along the Louisiana-Mississippi line, west of Macomb, are watching him for heading southward. So he races forward, crosses the Amite River, the Kamite River. He's 7 miles out of Baton Rouge. Grant has crossed the Mississippi at Bruinsburg, and on the first day of May, has secured his bridgehead on the west side of the Mississippi. On a small scale, it's just like the landing in Normandy at Omaha Beach. He's now on the high ground. He's now on across the river, the mighty river. He has a bridgehead. And, of course, the Battle of Port Gibson is on the first day of May. At daybreak on the second day of May, where is Grierson? He arrives at Baton Rouge to the cheer of the Union troops in Baton Rouge. Thus, now Grant is now across the river safely. He has moved his men into the area north of Port Gibson, between the watersheds of the Bayou Pierre on the south and the Big Black on the north. Grierson is, and the people who would have been instrumental in preventing this from happening have been maneuvered out of positions. Confederates in northwest Mississippi, or south of Memphis, are looking for Grierson up there. The people in northeast Mississippi have followed Hatch, who's a decoy back into West Tennessee. General Loring's men are in and around Jackson, scratching their head, wondering, and they're going to now be ordered too late to move up and reinforce the Confederates at Port Gibson. So this is one of the great cavalry raids of the Civil War. It is a raid in which it is greatly facilitated Grant's successful crossing of the Mississippi River. It has placed him on the high ground east of the river, in the area of north of Port Gibson, and enables him to go on his campaign, which between the first day of May, he will beat the Confederates at Port Gibson, beat them at Raymond on the 12th day of May, capture Jackson where the North South Railroad coming from New Orleans in Union hands, crosses the railroad east-west railroad, the Mississippi Southern. Then, after capturing Jackson, Grant on the 14th, Grant turns west, defeats the Confederates in the decisive field engagement at Champion Hill, defeats them on the 17th of May at the Big Black, and, of course, Vicksburg is surrounded, and Vicksburg will fall on the 4th day of July. So Grierson has conducted one of the great raids of the Civil War.
What was the role of the Butternut Guerrillas?
The Pentagon Guerrillas. They are about a score of men who are attached to him. They're Union soldiers. They are what we would call partisans now, or rangers now. And they operate as he moves southward along the Pontotoc Ridge. They move out and cut the north-south telegraph lines that run from the Confederate bases around south, about 40 miles south of Corinth, which is held by the Union, and Meridian. They also cut the railroad and the telegraph lines, because wherever you have a railroad, you have to have a telegraph line. They also leave detached by Grierson, and they move west and will cut the railroad that goes north from Jackson up to Jackson, Tennessee. So they add confusion and have comfort for the period that's crucial to Grant getting across the river for about between the 25th day of April and the action at Union Church on the 28th day of April. Pemberton has forgot all about Grant. He's concentrating on Grierson and his Wilderness Raiders. Now, Grierson only loses 3 dead men on this ride. He loses about 10 wounded in engagements, and so it's a great return for a little investment.
Okay, what happened to Grierson after the Civil War?
Grierson stays in the Army. He will become gain quite a bit of note, because after the war, the Army will cut back, the Union Army. And when they cut back, under the cutback first in 1866 and then in 1868, they reduce, since there's going to be more of a demand for cavalry in the Army than there were before the war, there were only 5 mounted regiments in the United States Army before the war. They're going to create 5 new regiments to protect the Western expansion and the railroads that are being extended from the first transcontinental railroad and the settlement of Oregon and California. They will organize 3 new regiments, 2 white regiments, and for the first time, they'll have blacks in the United States Army. So Grierson, they will have 2 black cavalry regiments, the 9th and the 10th Cavalry. And Grierson will command the 9th Cavalry for a considerable period in the post-war army. These are the people that gained fame as the Buffalo Soldiers. At the same time, between 1869 and the turn of the century, there are 25 infantry regiments in the Army, but there are only 2 black infantry regiments out of the 25. That's the 24th and the 25th. The black cavalry regiments are stationed principally along the frontier, particularly in Texas and New Mexico. Grierson will command at Fort Davis in Western with the 9th U.S. Cavalry. So he becomes very, very noted as commander for much of the time until he retires in the early 1890s. He will command on the frontier the 9th U.S. Cavalry. Because the Indians principally refer to the black cavalry regiments as the Buffalo Soldiers. They sometimes call the 2 infantry regiments Buffalo Soldiers, but the ones that they put the monuments up to are the 2 cavalry regiments.
One last question. The Horse Soldiers with John Wayne, directed by John Ford. How close is that to Grierson's raid?
Not very close. It is not one of his great movies. For instance, if I hadn't been courting, this is between you, if I hadn't been courting the woman that will become my wife, I would have walked out of the movie. They take a woman, they have to have a heroine along, and they take a woman along in the raid. But worse, now, in the Civil War, the cadet corps of BMI, of 248 strong, will fight a battle in the Civil War at the Battle of New Market. The people in the cadet corps are primarily from about probably 17 to 19 years old. So what do they have to have a cadet corps out fighting against Grierson? They will be using the cadet corps from Jefferson Military Academy. This doesn't happen. The Jefferson Military School are boys that are in their early teens. They're not 18 and they're not 16. They're not 17, 18 years old. In fact, they're so young that John Wayne catches one and spanks one. So they think of something that really happened in the Virginia Theater of War, transferred to Mississippi, and instead of having the cadets being between 18 and 17, the cadets are boys 14 and 15 years old. So with those two things, the woman going and the scene with the Jefferson Military Academy cadets engaging Grierson, if I had been there alone, I'd have walked out.
Okay, well, fortunately you didn't. Thank you.
Because
for...
if I walked out, she would probably thought I was an overbearing klutz and we wouldn't have got married.
Well, fortunately it worked out. Thank you, Ed, for bringing history to life again, as always, and hopefully we'll be talking to you soon in a couple of months.
Very good. Thank you so much. It's always fun talking to you.
Thank you, Mr. Bars.